Hello friends, welcome to Anatomy Physiology video lecture series. Myself, Varaprasad Sarkar, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology and Pharmacy Practice, Vignan Pharmacy College. Hello friends, today we are going to learn about endocrine system. What is endocrine system? Endocrine system is a system of glands that controls and coordinates all the body functions, physiological activities. Here, the nervous system and endocrine system both coordinates all the functions of our body. The endocrine system, which regulates the physiological activities by our molecules called as mediating molecules or regulating molecules called hormones released into the bloodstream through interstitial fluid. Endocrine system not only regulates the activity of smooth muscles, all sorts of muscles, but it also affects the all sorts of tissues. Hormones, which usually regulate or maintain the metabolism of our body, growth and development of our body, and also influence the reproductive process. Let us see the location of many endocrine glands. Here we can see the endocrine glands like hypothalamus and pituitary gland, which are master gland of all glands, and pineal gland, which is the smallest gland in our body, which helps in maintenance of circadian rhythms, and thyroid gland and parathyroid glands, which are present at the neck region, at the larynx, above the larynx, which helps in the maintenance of our all body physiological activities. Next one is thymus gland, which secretes immune hormones called as leukotrienes or prostaglandins, which helps in the maturation of WBC. And the next one is adrenal glands. Adrenal glands, which helps in the metabolism of glucose and also the absorption of minerals from our body, and also helps in the maintenance of our stress levels or stress conditions. And the last one is gonads, which helps in the production of oogonia or spermatozoa in ovaries and testes respectively. There are two types of glands in our body. They are nothing but exocrine glands and endocrine glands. Exocrine glands secrete their products into the ducts, which carry the secretions into body cavities, thus to confine to local areas. Example, salivary glands, they secrete saliva into the oral cavities. Salivary glands are exocrine glands, and their secretions are limited to a particular region. They are nothing but oral cavity. Endocrine glands secrete their products or hormones into the interstitial fluids, and then enters into the bloodstream, and later they adds at distant places or forever places. Like for example, FSH and LH are released by pituitary gland, which acts on gonads, which are far away from the pituitary gland. They act at very low concentrations and at distant part of our body. Usually, hormone affects only target cells which has receptor molecules or receptors. Then, coming to the glands, hypothalamus and pituitary gland. Thalamus is the integrating part. We all know that thalamus acts as an integrating part between nervous system and endocrine system. Thalamus, which usually helps in our painful, stressful areas and emotional experiences, which gives all activities to the hypothalamus, where hypothalamus, based on our activities, it sends impulses or it sends information to the endocrine system. Hypothalamus, which consists of autonomic nervous system, which regulates the temperature, body temperature, we call it as thermoregulatory center, thirst center, hunger, sexual behavior, defensive mechanisms, etc. The hormone secreted by the hypothalamus, which activates the pituitary gland, and pituitary gland, which helps in the maintenance of homeostasis, growth and development, and metabolism. So here we can see the pituitary gland, which is hypothalamic neurosecretory cells, which enters into the pituitary gland. A pituitary gland, we can see in detail here. We can see the detail. Pituitary gland. Here we can study the anatomy of pituitary gland. Pituitary gland, which consists of two lobes, mainly
posterior pituitary, and anterior pituitary. Posterior pituitary, which is linked to the hypothalamus by means of a stalk-like structure called as infundibulum. Okay, and anterior pituitary is also called as adenohypophysis, and posterior pituitary, which is also called as adenohypophysis, since it is glandular portion, or it has glandular structure. Whereas posterior pituitary is also called as neurohypophysis, which gets the neurons from hypothalamus. Directly from hypothalamus, the neurons enter, or neurosecretory cells enters into the posterior pituitary. And posterior pituitary only stores and releases the hormones whenever necessary. Next, pituitary gland. We'll study about pituitary gland. We already studied the pituitary, anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary. And here also we can see the posterior pituitary. And coming to the in detail anatomy of anterior pituitary. Anterior pituitary also called as adenohypophysis, and it is influenced or stimulated or regulated by another hormones called as releasing hormones, and inhibited by inhibiting hormones which are released from hypothalamus. Major hormones and anatomical structures that are present in the anterior pituitary. Anterior pituitary, which consists of totally 5 groups of cells, which are secretory cells or else glandular cells, 5 types. What are they means? First one, somatotrophs, which are present in the anterior pituitary, secretes a hormone called as human growth hormone or somatotropin, which secretes further secretes insulin growth factors from the tissues. And these insulin like growth factors, which helps in the uptake of insulin from into the cells from the blood, and helps in the metabolism, which helps in the general body growth. And the second group of cells are called as thyrotrophs, which secretes a hormone called as thyroid stimulating hormone or thyrotropin, which regulates the activities of thyroid gland, and follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone, which stimulates the development of follicles such as ova or oocytes, and spermatogonia or sperm cells. And luteinizing hormone, which helps in the maturation of the gametocytes, also secretes some sort of hormones which helps in the maintenance of primary and secondary sexual characters, like testosterone in males and estrogens and progesterone in females, which is secreted from a different group of cells called as gonadotrophs. Next one is prolactin means, which helps in the initiation or production of milk, which converts the blood into milk. It is secreted from the anterior pituitary from a group of cells called as lactotrophs. And the next one is adenocorticotropic hormone or corticotropin. Which is released from corticotrophs, which are a group of cells that are present in anterior pituitary. And these corticotropic hormone or corticotropin, which acts on adrenal cortex to release mineralocorticoids, glucocorticoids and sexual hormone. Coming to the posterior pituitary, as I already said, posterior pituitary or neurohypophysis doesn't synthesize any sort of hormones, but it does stores which are released from neurosecretory cells present in the hypothalamus. We call them as hypothalamic neurosecretory cells. And those hormones are oxytocin and antidiuretic hormone, also called as vasopressin. Oxytocin, which usually helps in the maintenance of uterine muscles and other sexual characters in the females. Whereas antidiuretic hormone, which helps in the decrement of urine. It increases the reabsorption from the urine, nephrons. Means it preserves the water content of our body, water and electrolyte content of our body. Since when there is a lack or decreased electrolytes or water in our body, then automatically the hypophyseal portal system will alert the hypothalamus to secrete some sort of hormones onto the posterior pituitary, which helps in the release of anterior and antidiuretic hormone, which helps in the maintenance of our electrolyte and water balance in our body. Coming to the thyroid gland. Thyroid gland, which is a butterfly shaped structure present on the larynx, above the larynx, which has parathyroid glands also embedded in it. Thyroid gland has follicles. We call them as follicular cells. It has follicles, and in each follicle there are a group of secretory cells called as follicular cells. These follicular cells will produce two types of hormones called as thyroxine, or also called as tetraiodothyronin or T4, because it contains four iodine atoms, and another one is T3 or triiodothyronin, which contains three atoms of iodine. And this thyroid hormone secretion is regulated by means of hormones called as thyrotropin releasing hormone, TRH. Okay, and these thyrotropin or thyroid hormone helps in the regulation of oxygen use. It helps, or it increases the oxygen metabolism of our body, and it increases basic metabolic rate, cellular metabolism, and growth and development. And it also consists of parafollicular cells, means between the follicular cells there are separate cells called as parafollicular cells, which produces a sort of hormone called as calcitonin. Calcitonin helps in the regulation of calcium homeostasis. Here we can see the anatomical structure of thyroid gland. Here we can see a connecting part between two structures called as isthmus. Here we can see a connecting structure between two lobes of thyroid gland is called as isthmus. See, here you can see follicular cells and parafollicular cells. So this is the thyroid gland, this is the thyroid gland, and in the thyroid gland there are follicular cells, which are secretory cells. They secretes their contents into the lumen of the thyroid gland or the thyroid glands. And apart from this, between follicular cells, between each follicle there are separate cells called as parafollicular cells, from which we will have calcitonin. Parathyroid hormones or parathyroid glands. Parathyroid glands. Here we can see parathyroid glands. Here we can see parathyroid glands. There are two pairs of parathyroid glands in our body. Two pairs of parathyroid glands in our body. Each pair is on each lobe. Okay, and it consists of two kinds of epithelial cells. They are chief cells and oxyphil cells. Chief cells produces parath hormone, and oxyphil cells, till now its function is not known. And PTH, are also called as parath hormone, helps in the production of maintenance of calcium homeostasis. Parath hormone, which helps in the removal of calcium and phosphates from bone into blood by increasing the number and activity of osteoclasts. Parath hormone also helps in the reabsorption of calcium, and it is the adrenal glands, two adrenal glands, a pair of adrenal glands, each on each kidney. And while coming to its anatomy, here we have two regions. This is divided into two regions, and it is covered entirely covered by means of a connective tissue. We call it as capsule, and it has two tissues, which is outermost one is adrenal cortex, and the middle one is called as adrenal medulla. Okay, and here we can see the complete anatomy of adrenal gland. We said there are two structures or two parts of adrenal gland, visually adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla. Adrenal cortex has three types of cells or three groups of cells, which makes the adrenal cortex to divide into three regions or three zones. They are nothing but three zones called as zona glomerulosa, which is present on the very top of the adrenal cortex. This is the zona glomerulosa, and this is the zona fasciculata, and the third one is zona reticularis. Zona reticularis. Here in zona glomerulosa, which produces mineralocorticoids. Mineralocorticoids means it is a steroidal hormone which is synthesized from cholesterol, mainly helps in the absorption of mineral ions. Here the corticoids like glucocorticoids or mineralocorticoids are nothing but it helps in the absorption into the blood, into the cells of our body from blood. So here mineralocorticoids, mainly the mineralocorticoids are three zones called as zona glomerulosa, which is present on the very top of the adrenal cortex. This is the zona glomerulosa, and this is the zona fasciculata, and the third one is zona reticularis. Zona reticularis. Here in zona glomerulosa, which produces mineralocorticoids. Mineralocorticoids means it is a steroidal hormone which is synthesized from cholesterol, mainly helps in the absorption of mineral ions. Here the corticoids like glucocorticoids or mineralocorticoids are nothing but it helps in the absorption into the blood, into the cells of our body from blood. So here mineralocorticoids, mainly the mineralocorticoids are in which main corticosteroid is aldosterone. Aldosterone helps in the absorption of mineral ions from our body. You can see its different structure, different types of mineralocorticoids and its structures. Like here we can see mineralocorticoids helps in the absorption of mineral ions. We call them as the corticosteroids. And zona fasciculata, which produces glucocorticoids. Zona fasciculata, which produces glucocorticoids, which helps in the metabolism, which helps in the absorption of glucose into our body and also helps in the metabolism of glucose. And zona reticularis, which produces weak androgen or else androgen, we call it as DHEA. DHEA means dihydroepiandrosterone, which is similar to testosterone, which has effects on masculinizing, which helps in the getting of secondary sexual characters. And the next one is adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla, which has a modified nervous cells. They are modified nervous cells. During embryonic stage of development only, a group of nerve cells will come and place in the, or which helps in the formation of adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla, which has cells, hormone producing cells called as chromaffin cells, which produces two types of amine hormones called as epinephrine and norepinephrine, are also called as adrenaline or noradrenaline. Next one is pancreas. Pancreas, which is present in the duodenum, attached to the duodenum, present in the gastrointestinal region or peritoneal region, and it is a mixed gland which consists of both endocrine and exocrine. The pancreatic cells are arranged in clusters. Those clusters are called as SE9. And these clusters of cells have these clusters of cells called as SE9, which have ducts. Through ducts, they produce digestive enzymes which are released into the duodenum. They are exocrinal part of the pancreatic cells. And there are some scattered parts or scattered group of cells called as exocrine SNI, which doesn't have any sort of ducts. So they are exocrine SNI, called as pancreatic ILs or islets of Langerhans. So these islets of Langerhans consist of four types of cells. They are A cells or alpha cells, which produces a hormone called as glucagon. B cells are beta cells, which produces an important hormone called as insulin. D cells are delta cells, which produces a hormone called as somatostatin, which maintains or which regulates the activities of somatotropin, are also called as growth hormone. F cells, remaining cells are F cells, which produces a peptide called as pancreatic polypeptide. Here we can see different types of cells in the pancreatic exocrine SNI. So here we can see exocrine SNIs. These are all exocrine SNIs, and in between there are endocrine SNI. This is endocrine SNI, through which there are different types of cells, and those different types of cells will produce different hormones. Like we studied, alpha cell secretes glucagon, beta cell secretes insulin, delta cell secretes somatostatin, S cell secretes pancreatic polypeptides. Ovaries and testes, nothing but gonads. Gonads, how they secretes different types of hormones. Gonads are ovaries and testes. Ovaries, whereas in females, whereas in males are testes. Ovaries helps in the production of ova, and whereas testes produces sperm cells, as we all know. But how they are produced means spermatogenesis and oogenesis both are influenced by means of two hormones called as follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone both acts on ovaries and testes. Both are present in males and females, and they act on both ovaries and testes. Okay, and apart from these gonadotropic hormones, they also produces some sort of other hormones which are stimulated or which are released, stimulated by gonadotropic hormones. Say for example, ovary produces three types of hormones. Four types of hormones. They are estrogens, progesterone, and inhibin, and relaxin. Estrogen and progesterone, they both helps in the maintenance of uterus, making of uterus, and production of ova or maturation of ova. Whereas inhibin, which helps in the inhibition of follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Whereas relaxin, during pregnancy, relaxin is released from ovaries and placenta to make the pubic symphysis elongate or dilate. Helps in the cervix dilation during labor or delivery. The male gonads, which produces another hormone called as testes, which produces a hormone called as testosterone, which is primary androgen, which helps in the maintenance of production of sperm and development and maintenance of male secondary sexual characters such as beard, growth, etc. Testes also produces inhibin, which inhibits the secretion of follicle stimulating hormone as a negative feedback.
Pineal gland, it is a part of epithalamus. Epithalamus, which is present above the thalamus. Epithalamus, thalamus, and hypothalamus. Hypothalamus, which is a continuation part of our pituitary gland. Whereas epithalamus, there is a small globular structure which consists of secretory cells called as pinellocytes,
and it is called as pineal gland. And it consists of sympathetic ganglionic fibers. Sympathetic ganglionic fibers. Sympathetic postganglionic fibers, which are present in the pineal gland, which ends in the pineal gland, and this pineal gland produces only one hormone called as melatonin. Melatonin is a hormone which, on oxidizing, it helps in the maintenance of our biological clock called as circadian rhythms. Means every cell of our body has a timeline for their production of each constituents. Means, for example, say like our cell, a cell has a timeline for production of enzymes, for production of proteins, for the production of any sort of chemical substances or any sort of chemical or physiological activities. And that particular time, or we call it as biological clock or else circadian rhythm of that particular cell. Likewise, our entire body has a circadian rhythm or biological cycle. Okay, so during sleep, this melatonin is released at higher levels, means tenfold times, means during awakening position, like when we are awake, it produces it at one level, and when we are asleep, it produces at 10 levels. So it generally regenerates our entire body. It regenerates our entire body, or resets our biological clock of our entire body. So it is very important. And one more important note to add about this melatonin. One, we have less sleep, there will be less amount of melatonin released, and this less amount of melatonin, which is not sufficient to regenerate the entire cell's biological clocks, so we feel tired. Okay, and this also helps, I mean, when the melatonin, when it gets oxidized, it becomes melanin, a pigment, a coloring pigment, which helps in the maintenance of our color of our hair, skin, etc. So when there is decreased melatonin, then there will be decreased melanin content also. So we'll have early aging of our hair or early whitening of our hair. So by this we completed endocrine system.